In Jesus' name we pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you very much for blessing me. Thank you for what you've done during this Congress. Thank you from the very first day to this very last day of the Congress that completes the week of this year. Lord, we just thank you for the great things you have done. We know you are taking level a higher level. I can see the signal already. We're praying, Lord, everything we have gotten here, we're going to heal by your grace in Jesus' name. Lord, this year we declare we're not grasshoppers, we're giants. We're champions. We're conquerors. We're more than conquerors. Whatever is happening out there, Lord, we're going to overcome. We're going to be more than conquerors. Jesus' name. Nothing, no news, good news or bad news, earthly news or worldly news, will separate us from the Lord in Jesus' name. We're going to keep on walking with you and living this God with the power of the Spirit of God for the rest of our lives in Jesus' name. Enemies will not draw us back from the Lord. Friends will not draw us back from the Lord. Family members will not draw us back from the Lord. We're going to hold the Lord till Christ comes in Jesus' name. We have opened our mouths to the Lord and we're not going to turn back. We swear our heart and we're not going to change. That by the grace of Jesus Christ, by the power of the Spirit of God, we need to stand until the very end in Jesus' name. In our lives, we're going to stand. In a ministerial life, we're going to stand. In a pastoral responsibility, we're going to stand. In the call you have been commissioned, you have given, we're going to stand. Jesus' name. No detractor, no boy will ever shoot us from the bed that you have given us. In Jesus' name. We're not going to kick them out of losing, out of what? This word you have given us that shows us the roadmap that leads to heaven, but to stay until the end in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, as you give us this challenge and this commission, this final message, we pray, we'll stay awake. The power will operate in every land, Lord. We pray, Lord, as we believe the Lord our God, we shall be established. And as we believe the appointed prophet of giving us, we go to prosper in Jesus' name. And this work the Lord will prosper in our hands. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much, you can see that. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20. And we're looking at verse 28. The Lord has done so much for us. We've learned so much. And now the Lord is telling us our inescapable responsibility to God's church. The church is there. Now we know what the church is. The church is the bride of Christ. The church is the flock of Christ. The church is the temple of the Holy Spirit. The church is a holy nation. And the church is these assembly of horrible people on their way to heaven. And the Lord is telling us, he has made us ministers and priests and teachers and leaders over that church of the living God. And he wants to tell us what our responsibilities are so that his grace will carry on without any deviation to the very end in Jesus' name. So therefore, verse 20, I'm reading from verse 28. Acts chapter 20, verse 28. It says, take heed therefore unto yourselves. He was talking to the ministers, he called them together. Just a gathering like this. He was about to give them a final charge. That's Paul the Apostle. A final commission, a final challenge. And he said, the very first thing is take care and take care of yourself. It says, take heed therefore unto yourselves. When he said that, therefore, he said, I've done my duty. If you look at the previous verses there, verse 26, wherefore I take you to record this day that I'm pure from the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. The whole counsel of God, from the very beginning to the very end, I declared unto them, from repentance to righteousness, and to a rectitude, and to the rapture, and to the rapture time, everything he declared unto you. He said, because I am free from the blood of all men, I now pass it on to you, that you'll take it unto yourself, that in your life you live according to that word, in your ministry you preach according to that word, in your illustrations, that you are going to give illustrations according to the word. You will not say anything contrary to the word, any illustration contrary to the word, any motivation contrary to the word, and you are not going to act in any way or behave in any way contrary to the word. It will be according to the word. Take it therefore to thyself, unto yourself, and to all the flock. And then you take it to all the flock. All the flock, the children are in the flock, are there in the flock, and the youths are there, and the women are there, and the men are there, and the workers are there. All of us together, the ministers too are there. He says, you take heed unto the flock of God you, and then he says, all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers. That is, you have no grudge in your heart. The GS put me, I didn't put you there. The Holy Ghost directed to me that you should be put there. It's the Holy Ghost that made you overseers and pastor over that flock, over that situation, over the flock, the part of the flock over there. And then he says, which he has purchased with his own blood. He says, you feed the church of God. And that's how you take care of the church of God. You feed that church. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 26. Our inescapable responsibility tells us in that verse I just read to you now, feed the flock. Feed the church, take care of that church, and feed them with knowledge and truth and understanding. In chapter 26, I'm reading from verse 16. Chapter 26, verse 16, but rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose. Here God was talking to Paul the Apostle. The Athenians tried to change that in the life of Paul the Apostle, and all the enemies and all the people that took him captive and put him in the prison in Philippi. That's what they tried to change. The purpose for which God raised him up. If the devil is going to fight anything at all in your life, it's the purpose for which we're raised up. If the devil is going to fight anything at all in the church, in Deeper Life Bible Church, it is to fight the purpose for which Deeper Life is raised up. The devil might kind of relate and release, you know, us from all the pressure and all the persecution if we deviate from the purpose. Once he knows that we're not fulfilling his own purpose of letting the people remain in their sin and remain in their depravity and remain in their defilement and remain in all their condemnation, and then there's no salvation. Once the devil knows that all we're talking about is earthly, how to get healed, how to get prospered, the devil might relate. He might say, well, they're fulfilling my purpose. The people are not being saved. The people are not being taken away from my camp and leading them to heaven. But when you keep to the purpose of which God has raised up this church, is going to fight. And that's the reason why they fought against Paul the Apostle and persecuted Paul the Apostle. But then Paul always remembered, I am raised up for a particular purpose. And even though it was in chapter 9, the Lord called him. Here is chapter 26. He still brought it back to mind. He recalled, this is the purpose for which I am called, and therefore I'm still going to stick with it. Look at that in that verse 16, for rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister. It's the Lord that made him a minister, not Barnabas. It's the Lord that made him a minister, not the Antioch church. It is the Lord that made him a minister, not the pillars in the church, Peter, James, and John. He said, I have called you for a purpose, and I, the God of heaven, I made you a minister. It's not the congregation that voted for us and made us ministers. It's the Lord himself that made us ministers. If we have any faithfulness at all, if we have any commitment at all, our faithfulness is to the Lord. Our commitment, our submission is to the Lord, not to the people that if they were not there when God called us. I can tell you that none of you here was there when God spoke to me, when he gave me the commission and said, this is the purpose for which I'm telling you to leave this and then concentrate on that. And I knew the call before I knew you. Anybody here, I knew the call before I knew you. If I knew the call before I knew you, the people that just came after, whether even my own children, my children were not there when I got the call. The children that come after, the wife that comes after, even my wife, I'm talking of the wife that, you know, gave birth to those children, Jerry and John, even that wife was not there when God called me. And therefore, anybody that comes after that, when we have received the call, we're not going to say, because this new person came now, and then we forget the call. And Paul never forgot, and you will never forget, in Jesus' name. Anybody that comes to your life, any situation that comes to your life, you want to say, before you came, here is the call I got, and I'm going to keep that call. You hold on to the fort and you send answer back to heaven. You say, Lord, as for me, there's no concern. By the grace of God, in the strength of the Lord, in the power of the Lord, I will keep it and I will hold on to it, and you hold on to it till the very end in Jesus' name. And then he says, to make you a witness both of those things which thou hast seen and of those things which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people. He told him already, you're going to have pressure. You're going to have persecution. You're going to have opposition. But I'm going to deliver you from those people and from the Gentiles unto whom I now send you to open their eyes. That's a call to open their eyes. You open their eyes away from darkness, away from all their tradition, and then you open their eyes to the gospel, to the light. And here it says, and to turn them from darkness unto light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins. That's what God told Paul the apostle. He said, I'm calling you so that they're guilty, they're condemned, and you're leading them out of that sin, out of the guilt of their sin, out of the condemnation of their sin, and then you're leading them to forgiveness of sin, and you're leading them to an inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. It was God that gave the message of sanctification unto Paul the apostle. And therefore some people may come after we're back from God, anybody that comes after that, and then he's telling us this and that. Are you going to exalt that man, that woman, those people, that group, that assembly? Are you going to exalt them above God? Yes or no? No, you're not exalt anybody, any group of people above God. If God had told Paul the apostle, here is the calling I'm giving you, and you must preach that sanctification, that holiness of heart, that righteousness, and then get people to have an inheritance among them who are sanctified by faith in Christ. Then you're faithful to the Lord. Say, Lord, that's what you told me. I'm going to keep on doing that until the very end. You will do it in Jesus' name. We have a responsibility. And we have a duty. We don't play with our responsibility. We don't play, we don't joke. We is our duty that God has given us. And then we don't trade and we don't gamble. And we don't negotiate with people, with anybody on the face of the earth. Even with an angel coming from heaven. And then we begin to negotiate, all right? Because, I want to be at peace with you. And I want you to understand me and love me. Some people are looking for so much love. They cannot live without all these sentimental things they call love. And because they'll pay any price, they'll drop their salvation to get love. They drop their sanctification. They'll drop their conviction so that people can accept me and embrace me and love me. That's too high a price to pay when you have to give up your soul because you're looking for something sentimental. But Paul the apostle said, here I stand, I have fought a good fight. We're going to fight a good fight in Jesus' name. Then he said, I finished my course. He looked at everything. He said, all the purpose for which Christ raised me up, I have fulfilled it, and I fought a good fight. I finished my course. And now there's a crown of righteousness, crown of life, and crown of glory waiting for me. I pray you'll get to that point where you know that crown is waiting for you in Jesus' name. If you do not negotiate the doctrines of the Bible with anybody, any group of people, if you do not negotiate and try to gamble and try to play a game with the word of God, and you're very serious, you know that is my destination. This is what God has called me for, and I'm going to stand for that until the very end. Whatever price you have to pay, it is then you'll be able to say, praise the Lord, you can send back the answer to heaven. I'm going to hold the fort. I'm going to hold on until the very end. And if all of us who are here will hold the fort and hold the watch of God and never make the gospel cheap and never throw the gospel down for anybody, then this nation will have hope in Jesus' name. And the continent of Africa and the world will have hope if we are going away from here, holding the fort and standing firm on this word of God that changes. And I'm going to talk about this in three perspectives. Number one, personal watchfulness for a greater service. Personal watchfulness for a greater service. If we're going to have a greater service in this new year, we're going to have a personal, watchfulness. I'm talking about this now in Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. The first part of verse 28, Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. I'm looking at verse 28. Here is what it says: take heed therefore unto thyself personal watchfulness. You watch your life. What's trying to come into your life? The things you dropped many years ago, and the things you kind of threw away many years ago, the things that were gained to me. All those I counted as dung, as dross, as something, as a waste that came out of my body, and I don't go back into them anymore. I dropped in the vomit that came out of my system, and I don't go back to that anymore. And when those things are trying to come, they are knocking at the door again. You know, the things of the flesh and the things of the mind and the things of the world and your relatives, they are coming back, and this and this, and now you are getting maybe older, and people are thinking that because you are getting older now, you know, he was like this 30 years ago, 20 years ago, we couldn't get his attention for this and that, but now maybe we can get his attention. If you go back to that, you're not taking care of yourself. You're not watching over yourself. You're not watching over the various areas that may crack in your wall, in your wall of protection. But when you're still watching, say, that will never come back, not into this life. I've laid that on the altar so many years ago, and that thing is going to still remain on the altar. That's why you have that personal watchfulness, because the Lord in your older days will be preparing you for a greater ministry, and you'll have it in Jesus' name. Personal watchfulness, personal watchfulness. That means that it's not after this Congress now, you just relax and feel everything is all right to finish the Congress. It is to prepare us for the life to come. It's to prepare us for all the days and all the weeks and all the months ahead of us in this new year. That's why we have the Congress at the first week of the year, so that all that we need, the courage we need, the conviction we need, and then the stability and steadfastness we need, the Lord gives that to us in the first week, and then we say, I can then go throughout the year victorious, more than a conqueror. That's what is going to happen in Jesus' name. In Luke chapter 21, I'm reading from verse 34. Here are the words of Jesus: take heed to yourselves. You see this? You know, Paul said it. Jesus Christ had said that before him. He said, take heed unto yourself. Lest at any time, your heart be overcharged with submitting our drunkenness and the cares of this life. Take heed unto yourself, so that at any time, what time? You know, times when things are peaceful, when everything is calm, when there's no persecution, when there's no opposition, when there's money coming in, when people are just, when even unbelievers are saying, we love the man. When even unbelievers are saying, we love that woman. And you take in another, because at that time, when everybody is loving, hovering around you and saying, you're a good person, you're a nice person, if everybody in our country is like you, this country will be all right. Well, can you help us hold this chieftain's title? Can you help us? I don't want to disappoint them now, because you know, they love me so much, and because of, I didn't even campaign, and they give me this political office, and they give me this and that. And then when you come in, then they tell you that those who are going to hold this office, they need to, this is just initiation. This is not, you know, don't misinterpret it. This is just this, and then you just pour this and pour that. It won't take one whole day. I hope your Christian something, because everybody is looking up to you. We love you now. We accept you now. And as we have accepted you, we have stretched forth the hand of acceptance to you also, you will accept us and then join our something. But if you stay back, they are holier than thou, and you condemn us, be very careful. And then you say, what will I do now? You're not even seek counseling, because you've got a position, and that position is going to take all that you got, all the conviction you built up for 30 years, for 40 years, all that little position is going to take that away from you. God forbid, in Jesus' name. That's the reason why the Lord himself said, lest at any time your heart be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness. Money is like alcohol to some. It makes them get sick, intoxicated. Other people, it is marriage that intoxicates them, that they cannot think about conviction anymore. Sometimes it is education that intoxicates people. The possibility of having a doctorate degree, just, you know, 2 hours in two nights, two evenings, and then for those period of years, you're going to have a doctorate degree. For other people, it's appointments that intoxicate them, like alcohol. And we can't talk to them again. You can't find them in the church. For other people, it is position, promotion in their places of work that intoxicate them like wine. And then they just get out of their senses. They are drunk. That's why Jesus said, take care that nothing will make you feel drunk. And then he says in that verse before, the cares of life. Cares of life. Caring for this and caring for this and caring for that. And they care for the things of this life more than they care for the things of heaven. They care for superficial things and things that will not last more than they take care of things that will take them to heaven. They spend more time thinking about things of the world. I look good before the world. I'm all right before the world. And they don't look good in the sight of heaven. That's why the Lord is saying, you take it a personal kind of watchfulness so that by the grace of God, you render greater service to the Lord in Jesus' name. It says in verse 35, as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the earth. Watch ye therefore, and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. The Lord is saying, take care, we shall take care. Well, take care. He said, take heed, and we're going to take heed in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 24. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24. Don't be so sure of yourself and then become so careless and let down your guards and leave the doors open, and everything then gets into your heart, into your life, into your family, and then we'll begin to say, how about this, all these cockroaches, all those lizards, how about all these reptiles now in your life? When did this thing come in? I was too sure of myself. It's self-confidence, overconfidence. I brought that into your life. As I say, say, close the door. That's why I say, shut the door. That's why I say, close your mouth. That's why I say, close your eyes. That's why I say, guard yourself. That's why I say, take it unto yourself. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24. It says, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize, so run that she may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery, if you're striving for the mastery, if you're striving for excellence, if you're striving to become extraordinary, if you're not going to be like every Dick and Harry and Round, it says every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do each obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep what? Under my body. You know your body. That's where to start. That's where to start. There are people that can discipline other people, they cannot discipline themselves. There are people that try to control other people, they cannot control themselves. I can tell you, if you try to control yourself as much as you try to control other people, leave the other people alone. We are Christians, we are ministers, we can control ourselves. We have the same Bible you read, we have the same conviction you have, we have the same messages you have heard, and instead of concentrating on controlling this and supervising this and disciplining this and checking this up and pushing this one under and cutting this one to size, instead of all that, you yourself concentrate on yourself. What will it matter if all the other people you're trying to control and discipline, you discipline them, and therefore they shape up and shake up and they get to heaven, and you, the same discipline you give them, you didn't give yourself, and therefore you go to hell. How is it you're taking care of all the other people? They made me the watchman for other people's vineyard, but my own vineyard, have I not cared? Keep your vineyard in verse 27, but I keep under my body, and bring it into subjection, lest by any means, when I have prayed to others, I myself should be what? A castaway. I pray you'll not be a castaway in Jesus. And point number two, the primary work of God's servants. The primary work of God's servants. He gives us a particular work, and this is the primary thing. And this is the priority of the work we need to do. And come back to Acts chapter 20. I'm reading from verse 28. Acts chapter 20. I'm reading verse 28. Take heed to yourselves. Take heed therefore to yourselves and unto all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God. To feed the church of God. To feed the church of God. That's our primary assignment. That's what he has given us to do. He says, this is the work I've given you. Take care of this. And take care of all the flock to feed the church of God. We're looking at Jeremiah chapter 3. Jeremiah chapter 3, here is a primary responsibility. And you note it down, then you don't allow any other thing. You know, there are people that become like errand boys to their local church. If anything is happening, is their driver to the local church, they are the wood hewer for the local church, they are the water drawer for the local church, they are the kind of postman for the local church. They do all those many things for the local church, and they call that humility. They abandon their primary assignment that the Lord has called them to do, and then they just run errands for people in the church. And if anybody has anything, you know, my child is sick, pastor, can you come and take my child to the hospital? I'm coming now, give me 30 minutes, I'll be there. And then when he finishes that, there's something happening there, my house is leaking, pastor, can you help me find this? I say, I'm coming, you'll get me 1 hour, I'll find someone to come and do it for you. And then, you know, my laundry is not working well, and what am I going to do? And my cooking gas is finished. How am I going to get? Pastor says, I'm coming, I'll contact them. They become errand boys for their members, for the members of the church. But the Lord is saying, I didn't give you that assignment. What I give you to do is that this is the primary work and the primary assignment that you're to do. Feed the church of the living God. In Jeremiah chapter 3 verse 15, it says, and I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. It says, I'm going to give you pastors. These pastors, according to my heart, there's one primary assignment that I'm going to give unto them. I'll give them the assignment of feeding my church and my people with knowledge and with understanding. I'm looking at chapter 23 of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 23, and there we're reading verse 4. Jeremiah chapter 23, and we're looking at verse 4. The primary work, the primary assignment, responsibility, and duty the Lord has given us as ministers, as the people that take care of the church of the living God. In Jeremiah chapter 23 verse 4, and I will set up shepherds over them, which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more. You see, when we feed the people with the word of God, they'll not fear Satan, they'll not fear death, they'll not fear anything, because we're feeding them with the word of God. They know that even if death comes, he said, they're not dead, they just change location. They just change, you know, their place of abode. You know, some people will say, so-and-so, we lost so-and-so. No, we didn't lose anybody. It's like, for example, now you are in Lagos, and then you relocated, and you are now in Port Harcourt. You are in Port Harcourt, you relocated to Kaduna. You are in Kaduna, you relocated to Jos. You are in Jos, or you relocated to Benin City. And then somebody says, no, we didn't lose him, he relocated. And when you move away from here, and then you relocate, you go to heaven, we didn't lose you. And the kingdom of God didn't lose you, the people of God didn't lose you. It's the language of the world that, you know, we lost so-and-so. You know that in that retreat that we had, we lost, you know, four people. No, we didn't lose them. In which place can you be that God will give you a promotion? It's at the retreat. Where at the retreat over there, where you're saved, and then you made right your life, everything was okay, and you arranged every detail of your life, and you say, Lord, I'm sanctified, I'm purified and holy and rapturable. And the Lord said, okay, because this is the best time of your life, that you have been so close to me, and this is the best time of your life, that everything has been searching your life, I want to give you a relocation. And then he calls them and he takes them to heaven. And then somebody is crying and saying, we're lost. No, we didn't lose anybody. Did we lose anybody? I said, did we lose anybody? That's why Paul the apostle don't sorrow as the people that have no hope. Therefore, we understand then that we're to feed people with the knowledge of the word of God until there's no fear in them. No fear of death. No fear of Satan. No fear of the people of the world. No fear that, you know, somebody so and so might frown at me, and so what? And so may not like me, and so what? We teach people the word of God and give them conviction until they don't care who loves them, who does not love them. That's why it says in chapter 23 of Jeremiah, it says, I will set up shepherds over them, which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall they be lacking, says the Lord. When we teach, that's our primary responsibility, that we so teach the word of God, the word of truth, that the people of God, they will not lack in Jesus' name. I said they were not lacking Jesus' name. We're looking at chapter 78 of the Psalms. Psalm 78. I'm reading there from verse 70. Psalm 78. We're looking at verse 70. 78, verse 70. Here we look at it. It says, he chose David also, his servant, and took him from the sheepfolds, from following the ewes, great with young. He brought him to feed Jacob, his people. He brought him from where he was to feed Jacob, his people. That's a primary assignment. The responsibility we have to the church of the living God is to feed the people of God, and Israel is inheritance. So he fed them according to the integrity of his heart. He fed them according to the integrity of his heart, not according to the presence of Jesse, his father. He didn't feed them, not according to when he was happy, not according to when he felt at ease, not according to when he didn't have any challenge at all. When he had all those challenges, he kept on feeding them, he kept on leading them, he kept on raising them up, he kept on putting courage and the faith in God in them, because he had integrity and faithfulness. That's what the Lord is telling us, that, you know, whatever your physical condition, you just keep on feeding the people of God. Look at 1 Chronicles chapter 11. 1 Chronicles chapter 11, and you see something marvelous there concerning this David, what he did, how he carried out his responsibility every moment and every time. In 1 Chronicles chapter 11, 1 Chronicles chapter 11, I'm reading there from verse 1. Here it says in verses 1 and 2, then all Israel gathered themselves to David unto Hebron, saying, behold, we are thy bone and thy flesh. All the people of Israel, they gathered together. They said, we know you, we recognize you. We are your bone, we are your flesh. You belong to us, we belong to you. Look at verse 2. And moreover, in time past, see this, and moreover, in time past, even when Saul was king, and chasing you here and there, it says, thou wast he that leddest out and bringest and broughtest in Israel, and the Lord thy God said unto thee, thou shalt feed my people Israel, and thou shalt be ruler over my people Israel. They said, even when Saul was alive, he had the position, but you took care of us. He had the title, but you were the one feeding us. You didn't care for position, you didn't care for title. Saul did not feed us. All he was doing was just to gather the army together and fight a personal battle. What he thought was a personal battle, only fighting David. But David was not fighting a personal battle, he was fighting the battles of the Lord. You see the difference? That's when people have title, their position, and all their fight, all their struggle, all their manipulation is to keep that position, is to fight for that position, is to fight for their prestige, is to fight for their glory, whatever, like Saul. But those of us that don't care for prestige or reputation or prestige or position or whatever, and all we want to do is to fight the battles of the Lord and to feed the people of God. That's why they said, even when Saul was king, you didn't care for us, you are the one caring for us, you are the one feeding us, and that is the responsibility that God has given us, that whether there is title or no title, position or no position, appreciation or no appreciation, the Lord has called us and he has given us this ministry of feeding the people of God with the knowledge of the word of God. We'll do it in Jesus' name. We're looking at John chapter 21 verses 15 to 17. John chapter 21. I'm reading there from verse 15 to verse 17. So when they had dined, Jesus said unto Simon Peter, Simon son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He says unto him, yes, Lord, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He said unto him, feed my lambs. That's all I'm asking from you. If you say you love me, if you say you accept my authority over you, if you say I'm your Savior, I'm your Lord, I'm your King, I'm your Master, if you accept my authority over you as your Redeemer, feed my lambs. And then he says in verse 16 again, and he says unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He says unto him, yea, Lord, yes, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He says unto him, feed my sheep. That's all he told him, feed my sheep. And then in verse 17, he says unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus says unto him, feed my sheep. You see that three times over. All Jesus, he wanted to repeat three times to make sure that Peter understood this, that there's no other assignment I've given you. There's no other responsibility I've given you over the church of the living God. Feed my lamb, feed my sheep, take care of yourself. And then when you are well fed yourself in the word of God, then you feed the people of God. Point number three, prudent watchmen. Prudent watchmen over godly souls. Prudent watchmen over godly souls. We're coming back to this Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 verse 28. Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 verse 28. Here it tells us in chapter 20 verse 28, take each therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. Why? For I know this. Verse 29. For I know this, that after my departure shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Paul the Apostle said, I'm telling you to feed, concentrate. Take care of yourself. Feed yourself in the word of God and feed the flock of God. He said, I'm saying that because I know, if you're not watchful, I know this, that after my departure shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise. Not just one man, shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. That's why we need to be very watchful. It's like, you know, when you have a congregation of maybe about 1,000 people, and then you have been feeding them and feeding them and feeding them, and while you're feeding everybody, you have knowledge of the word of God, conviction in the word of God, and all of a sudden, maybe you move out here, you move out there, and then there are men among those 1,000, they said, all these 1,000, if I'm able to confuse and convince about 100 and get that after me, we'll start a new ministry. And so one man does that, another man does that, another man does that. By the time you come back from where you have gone, wherever you have gone, and you left the feeding of the flock, by the time you come back, about five men have taken 100, they took 50, they took 70, they took this and that, and then you have a remnant remaining. And say, where did they go? We're told in the word of God, because men will arise among you, not sparing the flock. And they're going to speak perverse things and draw away disciples after them. Women may also rise up. I hear nowadays that there are women that are rising up in, you know, in our city here in Lagos. They're rising up in the city over there, maybe in another, I don't want to mention. And they're saying that they're praying. God has given them this gift. And if you bring your wife and they rub their hands on the belly of your wife is going to conceive. And there are some people that are so unwise, I don't want to say foolish. They're so unwise, I don't want to say unintelligent. They're so unwise, I don't want to say that they're so carnal. They're so unwise that they take their wives to such people, and then he says, well, if you're going to be here, it's going to take not just one time rubbing the stomach of your wife. You yourself, you're going to be there, because, you know, God is telling you that if you come over here, he's trying to shift you out of your where you are, and it's because you're looking for children at all costs. And then, you know, he's drawing away people, and then he's going, God says the Lord, God said there's somebody there, and then this and this and all that kind of fakes it. There's something that the GNA will call the gift of the Spirit. There's a fixing that some people do and just guess that, you know, this and this, and they say, ah, the man has the gift of God, the woman has the gift of God. And those men and women that will try to sway, they may not sway you because your minister, and you're standing, and you keep standing in Jesus' name. But if you don't take care of your flock, and you know, Thursday, Bible, you are not there. You're busy in another place. Monday, you are not there. Even though the message is coming to us from the headquarters here, you must be there yourself and see the people who are there. When they see the presence of their pastor, that their pastor is there, it will encourage them to come. But you know, you are never there, or your wife is never there at the Bible study, or maybe it's your children that are never there at the Bible study. What kind of example are you laying down for those people? Because there are people who are watching and they say, well, since it's not there, and then after the Bible study, the pastor is not there, they're going to say, wait, before you go, we're going to make an announcement for you. There is a prayer meeting that he said going, although they have attended Bible study about that announcement. Did you give them that announcement? And since you are not there, do you know what they are saying? There's a prayer meeting going on here and going on there, and you know, we want to encourage you, if you have been you know, looking for this and looking for this, we can give you some testimonies. And they will talk for 30 minutes after that Bible study. All that the people got at the Bible study, they forget everything, because you know, the pastor was not there. Or it may be that there's a meeting now, everyone, don't go away yet, we're looking for this and looking for that. Announcement and announcement after the Bible study. Everything we have learned at the Bible study, everything is forgotten. It's not just that they are still in Bible study. The fact is, what you say after the Bible study can either strengthen the hold of that Bible study in the hearts of the people, or can weaken it, or can make people to forget. And it's because people are looking for disciples after themselves. Sometimes they don't leave the church. They're still in the church, but you know, the pastor is not in total control. There's somebody there, he wants disciples. He wants the people to be, yes sir, yes ma'am, unto them. And because that's what they want, even after we have taught and we have labored and we have sweated, and then we teach the word of God from cover to cover, from the whole Bible, then there are some people that will still call them into the crowd. They don't leave the church, they're still in the church. And then they have these disciples after them. And the people they get after them within the church, they are more loyal to these men, to these women, more than they are loyal to God, more than they are loyal to Christ, more than they are loyal to the general superintendent of the church, more than they are loyal to the leader that God has appointed in the church. That's why Paul the apostle said, be prudent, be wise, be vigilant, and watch, and be a prudent watchman over the flock of God, over those godly souls, because he said, also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Did you see that? With what? Tell me out loud. With tears. You know, there are some people, if I'm talking, not that, who plans to weep when he's preaching, who plans to cry when he's preaching. But if what I'm saying grabs me and grips me, and if I see souls drifting, if I see souls on their way to hell, and all of a sudden my heart is broken, and then I begin to cry, and now in their heart they say, pastor, be a man. No, Paul was a man. There's no man that has such backbone and conviction, that has such stability as Paul the apostle. See that man, he was shipwrecked, he didn't care. He was in prison, he didn't care. And then he put all those weaves and lashes on. He said, I can bear more of that. In prison, he stayed there. And he said, tell that man and Silas, let them go out of prison. He said, me go out of the prison. I'm not going out of the prison. That man, he was a man that has resilience. He had resilience, he had courage, he had stamina, and he had backbone. He wasn't a weakened man, he wasn't a child. You know, some people, they say, ah, pastor has become, he's, you know, acting like a child again. Because you don't have the fire, because you don't have the passion, because you don't see those souls going to hell, you don't see what I see. If you see what I see, you'll be broken down. And so Paul the apostle said, I've been warning you, I just don't stay here and just warn you in such a placid way, in just a lukewarm way, that you know, you feel the fire, you feel the way I feel, you know what I say, and you know the way I talk. That's what Paul the apostle said. You need to listen here. Let me show you Philippians chapter 3. You know, they say, you know, pastor, when is the pastor going to get out of this kind of crying like a baby? Be a man. I'm a man. I'm more than a man. I'm more than a conqueror in Jesus' name. I'm looking at Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. And I'm looking at this in verse 17, verse 18. Brethren, it says, before the Lord together of me, and mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example. For many walk of whom I have told you often and now tell you, even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. When you see people that are shifting the foundation, that are destroying the foundation, when you see people that are making others to go away, when you see people that those who have consecrated laid everything on the altar by their influence, by their counseling, by their kind of whatever it is they're using on them, they're making them to shift away from the truth. It will break your heart that you're leading these people to hell. And Paul the apostle said, I told you before, I'm telling you now, even weeping, that these are the enemies of the cross. And he tells us there in verse 19, it says, whose end is destruction, and whose gorge is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, and who mind earthly things. That's why he told the people, now you need to be prudent watchmen, watching over the people of God. We're going to watch in Jesus' name. In Jude verse 3, in Jude verse 3, I'm reading there in Jude, we're looking at verse 3, it says, beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that ye should earnestly contend. Honestly contend for the faith which was delivered unto the saints. That's what the Lord is telling us, that as we go back, you must watch over the doctrine and watch over the people and watch over the Christian experiences and watch over everything the Lord has given us, so that nobody will shift us away from the foundation, away from the base. We're looking at Proverbs chapter 22. Proverbs chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 28. Proverbs chapter 22, we're looking at verse 28. Remove not the ancient landmarks which thy fathers have set. Remove not the ancient landmarks. These are, you know, modern days, but in the same word of salvation that will take us to heaven. These are modern days, same doctrine of holiness that will take us to heaven. This is a modern period, but it's the same word of Holy Ghost baptism that will empower us and energize us for the work we have to do. It says, remove not the ancient landmarks which your fathers have said. I'm looking at Proverbs chapter 24. Proverbs chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 21. My son, fear thou the Lord and the King, and meddle not with them that are given to change. My son, fear thou the King, and fear the Lord, and meddle not with those associate with them. Don't be so familiar, don't fraternize with people that are given to change. And the people that want to change you, all their passion, all their desire, all their project, all their plan is to change this man. He talks too high, he talks too much, he's too fiery, he's too fervent, and he's too narrow-minded. Let's change him. And when you see there are people like that, don't befriend them, don't fraternize with them, and don't fellowship with them. Maybe not with them that are given to change. If you're going to keep the fire, you're not going to, you know, stay near people that are going to be pouring water there to quench the fire. If you're going to keep your zeal, you're going to keep your fervency. If you're going to keep your faith, you're not going to be associating with people that want to destroy your faith. There are people that overthrow other people's faith, and they do it gradually, and they do it consistently, and they do it with determination and diligence. Just like we are zealous for the Lord, they are zealous for Satan. Just like we are zealous for sound doctrine, they're zealous for false doctrine. And they will use all means, they will use all means. If they can use pressure, they use pleasure. If they can use whatever they call sentimental love, they use sentimental love just to get you away from your base and to tell you that this is too much. Don't you slow down? What, you know, the people don't appreciate, whether they appreciate or not, who cares about that? We're committed to the Lord, and the Lord is saying, Ezekiel and Ezekiel, go and tell them, whether they will fear or whether they will forbear, tell them everything I've told you. That's what I'm doing, and I've told this church the word of God, and I'm praying every one of us will stand by the word of God in Jesus' name. and you meddle not with those who are given to change. That's what I try to practice in my life. If I see anybody that is trying to, you know, change the doctrine, no holiness, no sanctification again, and there's no evangelism anymore, there's no commitment, there's no consecration, and then all this doctrine we cannot stay to, you know, keep to everything. You have to kind of sit and you have to choose whether to drop this and to hold this. If I see you, that is your method, and that's your project that you are getting near to me, because you want me to change. The Lord has told me already, and I read that almost every time, meddle not with them that are giving to change. We're not going to fraternize with you or be friendly with you or fellowship with you when we see that all you want to do is to change us from this eternal truth the Lord has given us. We're going to remain on the truth in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen. I'm reading here from 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1, I'm looking at verses 13 and 14. 2 Timothy chapter 1, we're looking at verses 13 and 14. Here it says, hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me. He said, hold it fast. If you hold it with a loose hand, they're going to drop it. But hold it fast. And then he says in that verse 13, in faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus, that good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. We have something good. I said we have something good, and we're going to keep this something that is good in Jesus' name. But you know, the people that will come to you, they'll tell you stories. So there are people that know to tell stories. They ought to tell all this, you know, this and that. And then you are nodding your head and say, they know they are catching you, they know they are getting you. And eventually, when they bring the conclusion is everything you've been standing for before, why don't you just reconsider it this way? Let me show you. In First Kings chapter 13. First Kings chapter 13. I'm reading here from verse 16. In First Kings chapter 13, in verse 16, see what it says. And it said, I may not return with thee, nor go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water with thee in this place. For it was said to me by the word of the Lord, that thou eat no bread nor drink water there, nor turn again to go by the way that thou camest. And he said unto him, I am a prophet also, as thou art, and an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord, saying, bring him back with thee into thine house, that he may eat bread and drink water. But tell me the rest. Say it again. Say it again. You know, that's why you should be very careful about illustrations. And since you came to this place, you know, there's some weird illustrations that some people gave while they were preaching. Illustrations that, how could you say that? Look at the Word of God, look at the Bible. How could you say this, and then the illustration so far, what are you trying to demonstrate? And then some people will take that and go and give that kind of satanic illustration to their congregations. And you say, a revelation came, that's no revelation. We should be thoughtful and compare everything you say, everything you hear, every illustration with the word of God. And it says, an angel spoke to me, but a lie unto him. And if any angel tells you any other thing, that's an angel from Satan. An angel that will pervert the gospel, that will change the word of God. We're not even talking of men. If an angel tells you something that is not according to the word of the Lord, the Bible says you reject that. What then? What about men? What about women? Look at Galatians chapter 1. In Galatians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 8. Galatians chapter 1, we're looking at verse 8. But do we, here's Paul. He said, Paul said, if I come back to tell you, this is what we are preaching before, that Jesus only the Savior, and Jesus only is the sanctifier, and Jesus only is the healer, and Jesus only is the baptizer in the Holy Ghost, and therefore Jesus we are waiting. If I come back with Silas, if I come back with Timothy, if I come back with all the other ministers, and then if we say unto you any other thing which we said before, and if anybody in your location, in your region, in your state, in your nation will tell you any other thing, apart from what we're reading here in this word, is a liar. And the father of lies is a companion of Satan. And you're going to reject him. You're going to reject her in Jesus' name. Look at verse 8. It says, but though we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, tell me the rest. Let him be accursed. That's Paul the apostle. And he tells us in verse 9, as we have said before, so say I now again. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which ye have received, let him be accursed. We're going to keep to this word. I said you will keep to this word. Look at 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 1, 2 Timothy chapter 1. Chapter 4, verse 1, I charge thee therefore now before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick, the living, and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, we'll do it. I said we're going to do it. Preach the word without fear, without favor. Preach the word without looking at people's faces. Preach the word without being fearful of the consequence. Preach the word without fearing persecution. Preach the word without fearing that people are going to desert you. Preach the word. Preach the word without thinking that people may withdraw their money. They may withdraw their, you know, whatever help they're rendering to you. We're talking about something eternal. Money and all those other things, they're temporal. Whether you have that or not, that doesn't matter. If you die of hunger, you go to heaven. If you die of thirst, you go to heaven. If you die without praying, angels will come and, you know, hover around you and take you to heaven. You know, that man that died, that's Lazarus when he died. We didn't hear that people came around and they celebrated, but the angels came and he took him to heaven. So don't worry about if I preach the word of God, I might lose my friends, I might lose, you know, well-wishers, I might lose this, I might lose that. Don't worry about all that. Preach the word. And then he says, be instant in season, out of season. Reprove and rebuke and correct, and it says exhort with all long suffering and doctrine, for the time will come when you will not endure sound doctrine. The time will come and the time has come, but after their own law shall they heed to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from hearing the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things. We're going to watch. Endure afflictions. Well, we'll endure. And then it says, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. We're going to do that in Jesus' name. Verse 7, I have fought a good fight. Will you fight a good fight? I've finished my course. Will you continue till you finish? Answer me. I have kept the faith. Will you keep the faith? Look at verse 17. It says, notwithstanding the Lord stood by me, with me, the Lord will stand with you. And strengthen me, the Lord will strengthen you, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear. Paul the apostle felt responsibility for all the Gentiles to hear. He said, I'm not passing it on to other people. All my time is going to be spent in preaching the gospel. And I'm going to get to all the Gentile nations so that they will hear the word by my mouth. And it says, and I was delivered from the mouth of the lion. The Lord will deliver you. And the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work. He'll deliver you from every evil work. And then he says, he will preserve me unto his heaven. The kingdom and to whom glory forever and ever. And the church said, rise up and tell the Lord you are going to be like that with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. You are going to be a watchful person. Personally, you are going to watch over your life, and you are going to watch over everything the Lord has given us, this gospel and this doctrine. You are not going to play with it. You are not going to joke with it. You are not going to gamble. You are not going to kind of make transaction. Give me money, I give up my doctrine, and give me this, and I give up what I believe. No, you don't want to gamble. You're not going to make any transaction with the word of God. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. I'm going to stand on the word and stand with the Lord until the very edge. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord and say, oh Lord, here am I. Oh Lord, here am I. Oh Lord, here am I. I'm going to keep to this inescapable responsibility to God's church until the very edge. Watch over yourself. Watch over your life. Whatever your experiences, whatever your conviction, Don't allow anybody to take those convictions away from you. God called you to feed the church. That's your primary word. Do it. Feed the church with the word of God. Don't be so careless that you abandon your congregation. Abandon the church. In pursuit of money, pursuit of position, in pursuit of reputation, in pursuit of material things. Stay with your church. Stay with the congregation. Feed. Teach. Lead. Make them strong and firm on the word of the Lord. You have backbone and spine spiritually. The apparent watchman over the congregation of the Lord that he placed you over. Meddle not with them who are given to change. Don't fraternize, don't fellowship, don't be friends. The people who are given to change, and the people who have made it their primary assignment to change you, to bring you down from the mountain top where God has put you. He wants to bring you to the low valley, to their own level. They won't yield, they won't surrender. That will lift them up and bring them to your level. Their goal, their work on so forcefully and zealously to bring you down to their level. Don't fraternize with them. Your fellowship with them. Meddle not with them who are given to change.
Let's call upon the Lord.